here, the light's green.
Test. Sorry, I'm mic'd up, Corrigan. If everyone start grabbing their seat, we're gonna get this show on the road. So thank you everyone for your patience. Hello, everyone. How are we doing tonight? And for those who are streaming at home, thank you for your patience. I know it's been, like all demo days, a little bit behind the eight ball, but we are so excited to be here in Atlanta. This is not only the cradle of HBCUs, but also the place where we kicked off our first cohort 1 year ago here. So it's so great to be back. I'm Mike Ma. I'm the managing director of the HBCU Founders Fund at NextCubed, and it is my distinct privilege to welcome all of you here and those at home to join us for an awesome, awesome evening tonight. Before we get into what I know you all came here for, which is to talk to the founders, I just want to give a little bit of context about NextCubed and who we are and what we're doing. So we are an accelerator. We've been doing this since 2017, and we have been accelerating the very best founders at the intersection of tech and equality for over 75 investments for the better part of the last 5-6 years. So just to tell the story of how we all got here, if you can indulge me for a second. In 2017, we started investing off our balance sheet and making our own investments. And over time, we expanded to actually not just investing in, but actually creating startups ourselves out of our venture studio, which really is a hallmark of how we approach acceleration. The difference between us and other accelerators, we're very hands-on. We're very programmatic. We believe not just in pitch day, but building great businesses. And a lot of that metal has been born out of our venture studio and our operator-first view of what entrepreneurship should look like. Fast forward to 2020 and post-George Floyd, post a lot of the events that are happening in the world, we started the HBCU Founders Initiative. And I'll say a little bit more about it. It's a nonprofit that's been focused on bringing entrepreneur skills to HBCUs far and wide. And that's something we're really excited about. And that laid the foundation for where we are today, which is the HBCU Founders Fund. And we closed our first round in 23, 1 year ago. And we've been deploying and been very active in the space since with first cohort and the cohort you'll see today. So just to jump back a little bit about the Founders Initiative, it is an educational organization that we've partnered with, a separate 501c3, and it is focused on building entrepreneurial skills for any founder. It does not have to be a venture scale enterprise. Anyone who has an idea and a desire to build a business, you're from an HBCU, we got you. The good news is, since that time, these founders have raised millions of dollars. They've gone on to Techstars and Black Ambition, and they've been out in the world. And then some haven't. And some are just going to build the next great apparel shop down the street, or they're going to build a services brand that's going to change a local community. We are all for any of those. Out of that, however, we actually realized, in addition to our curriculum, we need to have boots on the ground. So we're currently partnered with over 12 HBCUs, not only to provide the virtual programming, but to provide boots on the ground, hand-on support, feedback, and coaching and mentorship around entrepreneurial design and skills. In fact, we're going to be here this weekend, staying at the AUC, working on design thinking around changing the future of work with a whole bunch of really excited students, and that's how we're going to spend our weekend continuing the work of the initiative. So we're really excited not just to be here for demo day, but then also for this upcoming weekend. But let's talk about the fund. This has been the part that I've had the distinct honor of working with. We are investing in pre-seed founders who are going to build the next great business, and they happen to be from HBCUs, and we think it's going to change the texture, not of just the entrepreneurial landscape, but the venture landscape as well. So I'm not going to steal too much thunder, because you're going to hear from them yourselves. So before we get rolling, I also have to thank all the people that made this possible, starting with Costco, which was our anchor LP, both for the Founders Initiative as well as the first money into our fund. Bank of America, my former employer, which I'm very excited, and they're doing fantastic work supporting underrepresented, not just founders, but general partners and investors in the space and trying to change the view of the venture landscape. And lastly, the state of North Carolina has done a wonderful job, and we've gotten some wonderful partnership out of the North Carolina, as well as coming from the initiative from the White House to support and change federal and state monies to change the landscape of venture as well. So we're very fortunate and would like to thank all of them for making this day possible and this work possible for this past year and far beyond. So I'm going to shut up and get off stage to the right. And I'd love for everyone to welcome our first founder. I'm so excited to bring him to stage, Antonio DiPino, CEO of Scouts. Give it up for him.
Get it.
Appreciate it.
Gotta find my drone up. I miss you.
Testing. All right, we're good. Meet Miles, a Division II basketball player who dreamed of playing in the NBA. But just like 99% of most college basketball players, he doesn't make the NBA. However, he soon realizes that there are thousands of professional teams around the world that recruit international talent. Without much information out there, he tried to shoot for himself. He sends hundreds of emails to coaches, but doesn't get a response. Sends thousands of emails to agents, but still no response. The talent is there for Miles, but breaking into the international market is harder than he thinks. And how do I know this? Because I lived this journey myself. My name is Antonio DiPino, and having lived Miles' journey myself is why I created this platform. So a little bit about me. I was once a college basketball player and a pro athlete. I know I gained a little weight, guys. It happens. But just like most athletes, I too had zero idea how to start my recruiting process or where to begin. I got my first college offer from sending an email just like this. And I got my first pro contract from this exact Facebook DM that I sent to a coach in Portugal. I know, guys, it's in Portuguese, sorry. But this is what I learned throughout the whole process. For coaches, it's manual and time-consuming. Coaches are flying all around the world just to recruit the right player, talking to different agents, going by word of mouth. It's draining mentally and physically for them. And it's not getting any easier. The recruiting landscape is getting bigger and bigger with international talent popping up all around the world. Let's just look at this year's NBA MVP favorites. None of them are from America, if you notice, which further proves my point that international talent is here and it's here to stay. And this is how I've been trying to solve the problem for the past 3 years. So I put 3 years of hard work and grinding, recruiting and scouting for professional teams all around the world. I generated $1 million while doing this. But this isn't scalable, guys. And to be honest, it's super, super hard work, which is why I created Scouts, the tech and app side. So Scouts is a sports recruiting app that connects athletes and coaches to help automate sports recruiting. So essentially, we're a virtual scout for coaches and a virtual sports agent for the players. But let's just take away the athlete for a second. Let's talk about just the coaches. So we're a recruiting tool for coaches that allow them to scout and recruit directly from their homes, saving them time and money. And this is how we replace the event model. We're subscription-based. And we give access, insights, analytics to coaches and athletes to guide them through the whole recruiting process on the pro side and the college side. We also have over 200 active athlete subscriptions today. Financially, we're growing, and since our launch in January, we've grown 72% month over month and currently at $10,000 in MRR, with projections to hit 12 to 15K MRR just this month. Since our launch, we added 5,000 athletes to our platform and helped 43 guys sign professional contracts around the world, from countries you wouldn't even think of, like Botswana, Africa, all the way to Japan. We're changing the world in sports recruitment and changing the world in general. So our team is small, filled with ex-athletes that can score off the court and on the court. So together, we have over 10 years of experience in the NCAA's recruiting, pro sports market, we're agents ourselves, and just the recruiting process in general. So we all know Caitlin Clark. We know women's basketball has been going crazy. So this month, we're adding women's pro sports to our platform, followed by men's and women's college basketball to attack these both simultaneously. And we're currently raising $1 million to scale to the next platform. And we don't want to be like other recruiting sites who just throw sports and see what sticks. Our goal is to win in basketball, in college and pro sports, before we add any other sport. And that's been a big goal of mine, to hit that 1 million ARR mark this year. And you can follow us on our journey. We're going to innovate and change sports recruiting and make it accessible to people all around the world. So scan this QR code, follow us in what we're doing, and thank you guys for coming.
Yeah.
All right, everyone, let's welcome to the stage Blair Matthews from Zuri Fertility.
Hi, I'm Blair Matthews, co-founder, COO, and president of Zuri Fertility. Our mission is to revolutionize fertility care, making it more accessible, comprehensive, and tailored for today's families. One in six couples globally can't get pregnant. That isn't just a stat, it's heartache. And my wife Jasmine and I were one of those couples. Wasted time, uncertainty, and emotional turmoil all stood in our path to parenthood. But we're not alone. This issue affects nearly 5 million American couples annually, many of whom are underrepresented and underserved, with their barriers to fertility care often being economic, racial, and geographical. And on average, it takes couples 3.5 years to get a proper fertility evaluation and a medical diagnosis. But what's worse is that means they're not starting fertility treatment until 5 years after trying to get pregnant. Now, in the realm of fertility, time is of the essence. A delay in diagnosis can lead to significant emotional distress, costlier treatments, and more invasive procedures. It was at this point in our own journey, my wife, being a physician assistant, reached out to her medical network to get us the answers that we needed. And after accessing that care, we were ultimately able to overcome our challenge of getting pregnant, and we have 3 beautiful baby boys. And thankfully, they look more like their mom. Now, while we were able to access that care, not everyone has the same resources that we do. So my co-founder, Dr. Juliana, and I built Zuri. Zuri simplifies, streamlines, and personalizes the fertility journey, getting couples the timely answers that they need to pursue their path to parenthood. We provide a readily accessible and comprehensive fertility and family planning support. The Zuri app provides virtual access to licensed reproductive health physicians, a complete fertility home test with the medical diagnosis, individualized care plans with prescriptions, and that 24/7 care navigation support team, all provided in the comfort and privacy of one's home. See, with Zuri, weeks replace those years. The traditional process is confusing, it's time-consuming, and it's disjointed. Our unique process, with rapid diagnostics and custom treatment plans, accelerate that journey, getting couples to the answers that they need much faster, more effective, and way less stressful. That way they can focus on what truly matters, starting a family. And now, patients, a part of our pilot program, love our holistic approach. That's because we understand the fertility journey is not just physical, but it's also emotional. So we address those issues of stress and financial hurdles head on, giving our patients that resilience and aptitude on their path to parenthood. Because what they need, we will provide, and we do so in a massive market. In the US alone, there's a $33 billion opportunity, and that number continues to grow as the average age of would-be first-time parents continues to increase. But now, there's a huge problem. The direct-to-consumer market is fragmented into pieces. You have brick-and-mortar, home testing companies, and digital fertility solutions. But they're all solving one piece of the problem. We're not solving a piece of the problem. We're providing a comprehensive solution. And that's what patients are yearning for today. Patients today are yearning for that comprehensive solution which didn't exist until we built Zuri. We're poised for growth because we have the answers and we built a wait list of over 1,000 patients into the community. During our pilot, we're going to continue to enhance our customer acquisition strategy as well as collect and implement the feedback from our customers and iterate on our product. We found that we need to be hyper-targeted on this highly motivated population, perhaps the most motivated population in healthcare. And that's what we continue to plan to do during the pilot. That will help us launch into our national launch, in which will enhance our brand awareness and build out those sustainable growth channels. Now, the special sauce behind this audacious vision is our team. As co-founder, COO, and president, I bring my legal expertise into this complex, ever-changing field of fertility, which allows our team to pivot as the legal landscape around fertility continues to evolve. But most importantly, I'm a father, and I uniquely understand the importance and the purpose of what we're building for our patients. Dr. Juliana Zaccardelli is my co-founder, and she's our CEO. She's a physician with a wealth of experience in fertility clinics and venture capital. Dr. Omer Rahim is our chief medical officer and the leading male reproductive urologist in the country. And our head of product is Ryan Felt, who brings a lot of experience from growing early stage startup teams. Our extensive team is complemented by our advisors, all ranging from clinical expertise to legal and business strategy, as well as health equity. Along with our strategic partners, we know we are the right team to continue and successfully grow Zuri. Now, if you're looking to make an impact with your investment, you can scan the QR code and learn more about how you can join. We're currently raising a pre-seed round of $1.25 million. And if you or someone you know might be interested in the pilot, you can scan a QR code and click pilot. Zuri means beautiful. And at Zuri, we believe that everyone should have a beautiful journey on their fertility experience. So thank you, and let's make it beautiful. Thanks. Thank you.
All right. Let's keep it going for Eboni Boyd, the CEO and founder of Budget Collector.
So intimidated, maybe you can learn from me. Maybe cop a job, let you work, come and earn from me. How the f*** you hating on me, but ain't never heard of me. You got a 2.3, that's the nerd. Name a that's better than kill, they got skill, always.
Hi, guys.
Okay.
I'm Eboni Boyd. I'm the CEO and an underestimated founder who is here today to talk to you about a B2B AI product launching in a market that many investors have never even thought about. Ever since I was a teen, I have heard story after story of a museum just discovering a work of color suddenly. It's been like a leaky faucet where I would hear about it, but it was just not a consistent amount of works of color, and I feel like there's more. And so as I learned about the market, I soon discovered that 95% of the work that the museums own is locked up in storage. And most of the time, it's not properly digitized, and sometimes not even cataloged. To give some context, the British Museum, the museum with the largest collection in the world, 8 million items, they have a staff of 1,000, and there's really no way a staff of 1,000 can keep track of that many items. And it's easy, the proof that the British Museum can't keep track of what they have is through articles like this, where an FBI agent says, inventory is the reason there's rampant theft. And to give you some more context, the British Museum, an item was stolen from their collection that was put on eBay for less than 1% of its value. It's easy to see why museums are supplementing their revenue with selling pieces. These might be large multi-million dollar sales, but the question I ask the audience, if you don't know what you have, how can you sell the work? Budget Collector provides a pathway for museums to think differently with our AI cataloging tool. With the click of a button, you can inventory your items quickly. Our tool does several things, including a GPS, where we can tag where the item was located. In addition, we have an AI valuation assessment that we've done the research at Stanford University's human-centered AI program. They gave us a research grant to discover what's going on, how we can do this. The museum staff like what we're building. They say this will revolutionize their museum, makes their life easier, it's desirable, or simply, it's phenomenal. The reason the reviews are like this is because the behemoth, the biggest collection management software in the industry, is manual, labor-intensive, difficult to use, you're never gonna wanna use it. We're dream creators, and that this big guy, he's not like us, and there's little competitors. They don't even think the same way that we think. That's because we go beyond AI cataloging. We productize the data from our previously released consumer app into multiple useful products, leading with our AI-based inventory system being launched in December and our collection analysis tool being launched next month. But actually, it says here, we developed 3 of the 8 functions. Right now, we're at 7. They just wouldn't let me edit. And so, the museum staff say that $40,000 a year would be a drop in the bucket for them. If we close only 25% of the museums that we talk to during product development, we're at a clear pathway to $1 million in revenue. And this isn't my first foray in leading organizations. Previously, I worked in politics with data analytics to flip campaigns. And my last political job was as an executive director of an NGO. My co-founder, she's worked on top mobile development teams for Fortune 500 companies, and our dev and advanced AI team have been breezing past our milestones. So what I've told you today is that we're the team that discovered this large, lucrative market. We're the team that's already launched software in this market. We're the team that got the most prestigious research grants to study this market. And we're the team asking for $1 million to complete our seed round. If you're as ready to deploy capital as we are ready to launch, then scan the QR code and let's get started talking about investment. Thank you.
All right, all right. Let's go. Let's keep it going for my good friend, Cameron Clarkson, the CEO and founder of Book Blaster.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening, everybody. My name is Cameron Clarkson, and tonight it's my pleasure to tell you about our company, Book Blaster, where we're using artificial intelligence to revolutionize the way books are marketed and discovered all around the world. To get started, I want to introduce you to somebody. This is Dr. J. Thomas Smith, or Dr. J for short. Dr. J grew up in Detroit and right up alongside Motown. He dedicated his life to radio and got to rub shoulders with some of the best DJs in the game. When Dr. J retired, He put his passion, his wisdom, his experience into his book, Black Radio, a definitive guide for the history of black radio in this country. Here's the problem. Dr. J's book is not gonna sell. Not more than a few hundred copies. And I've got some more bad news. Dr. J is not alone. In the United States alone, there are more than 4 million books published every single year. And according to Publishers Weekly, most of them are not gonna sell more than 500 copies in their lifetime. Why? Is it because they're bad books? No. It's because book marketing is broken, slow, and expensive. But what if it wasn't? What if there was a way to use technology, artificial intelligence, to streamline the book marketing process and make it accessible to everyone? Ladies and gentlemen, good people, that's exactly what we are building with Book Blaster. With Book Blaster, in just a couple of clicks, you can generate a customized launch plan for your books, customized premium landing pages, mock-ups, ad creative. No design skills necessary. No going back and forth with freelancers. All of your marketing campaign designed for you in just the click of a button. But who cares, unless it works? Well, let's check in with Dr. J. Dr. J was able to use Book Blaster in the course of just 2 months. He was able to get his book to number one in 3 categories. But this is just the beginning. We realize that book marketing takes place all around the web. So this fall, we are excited to announce that we are releasing our Chrome extension so that your book data can come with you everywhere that book marketing takes place. But there's more. Having your marketing assets generated for you is not enough. So this fall we're releasing our campaign and analytics dashboard, where authors will be able to launch paid, earned, and organic campaigns directly from the Book Blaster dashboard, including with our new partnership with Publishers Weekly to reach their network of 69,000 librarians, booksellers, and publishers who are decision makers that can make an impact for our customers. But y'all don't want to hear about that. Y'all don't hear what we're gonna do. Y'all want to hear about traction. So, to date, we've helped nearly 500 authors from around the world and some of the top publishing companies, including Simon & Schuster and New York Times best-selling authors. And we've generated $100,000 in total revenue since our launch. You might be asking, why are you the team to do this? Before we generated that $100,000, before Book Blaster was software, a lot of people don't know, Book Blaster actually started off as a book. My book. It's called Bottomless Book Sales. And in it, I laid out a framework for any author to be able to automate their book marketing. And with that book and the framework therein, we made over $250,000 over 2 years before we launched Book Blaster, doing this work by hand. So we know the process works. We just needed a way to go faster. And so once we realized that, we looked around for a tool to help us go faster. We couldn't find one, so we built our own. And once we realized that we had something that could change the world, we said, well, now we gotta build a world-class team. So we got a world-class CTO, engineer, and UX designer. And we also said, okay, we need some world-class advisors. So we went up to New York and got the CEO of Publishers Weekly to join our board. We got the COO from TurnSignal, and we got one of the innovation leads from Microsoft to help drive our tech stack forward. We used our time in this accelerator to hone in on our target customer and refine our repeatable sales motion. We're ready to take off, and to do so, we're raising a little over $1 million to quickly scale our product and improve our technology. We're looking for investors that want to be a part of something big. You see, because it's bigger than books. When the right book finds the right reader, the world becomes a better place. If you're interested in helping us make the world a better place, one book at a time, scan that QR code. Let's have some coffee. Thank you for your time.
Woo. Let's go. Help me. Help me welcome Sheena Franklin, CEO and founder of Kept Health, to the stage.
Hi. I can make it, put your phone down.
Hi everyone, I'm Sheena, the founder and CEO of Kept Health. And this is Ashley, an early Kept member who one day started experiencing acne, rashes, and skin sensitivity to the touch on her face, arms, legs, and vaginal area. She went to several doctors, but not until she met with a Black female dermatologist who knew how to treat skin of color and who asked the right questions to uncover the root cause of her symptoms did she end a six-month ordeal. She was allergic to the copper in her IUD. Like Ashley and myself, roughly 70 million women of all skin tones experience at least two dermatological conditions every year that impact our hair, scalp, skin, and nails. They are caused by environmental factors and internal health concerns, such as thyroid disease, lupus, PCOS, menopause, and even the side effects of chemotherapy. According to Accenture, this is a high-need, high-demand market, and so our market penetration strategy focuses on women of color who have been traditionally under care for, setting the stage for continued market growth with all women, focusing on three core problems that impact women and their health. Long wait times that cause health conditions and skin conditions to worsen or simply going misdiagnosed. Currently, unfortunately, there are no strong AI models to help fill the knowledge gaps of physicians, as the current models are built with data sets that are 86% white and male, leaving women with higher rates of misdiagnosis. Our team brings together expertise in healthcare public policy and management, dermatology, women's health, machine learning, and data science to solve these problems. Through Kept Health, a health tech company where our mission is to help women thrive and clinicians deliver better care. Through patient engagement, real-world data, and clinical evidence, we draw key insights to improve misdiagnosis rates, treatment plans, inform policy, and advance research. Our first product is an AI teledermatology mobile app that leverages proven telehealth, our data that cuts across all demographics and health status, and patented algorithms, and this is how it works. For patients, simply download the mobile app and complete your personalized profile and manage all of your at-home activities. When you are ready, you can have an asynchronous virtual visit with a board-certified dermatologist. You can also have private chat conversations with a licensed esthetician to triage and manage your follow-up care. Now, for dermatologists who practice directly on our platform, select from a listing of open cases and receive a 360 view of your patient, which includes information from their mobile app profile, their medical intake form, and then AI point of care diagnostic recommendations directly from our system. That includes the skin tone, skin disease severity level, underlying health conditions, and prescription effectiveness, allowing you to make a more accurate diagnosis and treatment plan. We have three revenue streams. First, our affordable cash pay monthly membership plans for women. Secondly, brand co-marketing campaigns with skincare and wellness brands, consumer health companies, and retailers. Thirdly, as we grow and scale, we'll be able to provide data insights to life science organizations, academic institutions, and government organizations as well. We have three core advantages that build strong brand affinity. Let's see if I get it. Brand affinity, and this is for consumer health brands and retailers. There we go. It went back. Oh, we have three competitive advantages that help us build strong market affinity. That allows us to move faster and quicker than our competitors, big tech and big pharma. So they are specialized expertise in skin of color and women's health. trust and transparency with a user permission approach to data sharing. And lastly, our centralized machine learning system that allows us to continuously collect, generate, and analyze data directly from patients and physicians. Since starting KEPT, we've seen early success with our MVP. From securing a paid pilot with Johnson & Johnson Innovative Medicine and rolling out our practitioner network. Within the last several months, we've launched our first campaign and early app release, where in the last 5 weeks, we've secured over 500 members, 1,000 images, and 2,500 unique data points, as well as partnerships with various organizations. And our members tell us how we've helped improve their day-to-day health and wellness experiences. So our healthcare moonshot or vision is to provide affordable and accessible care to over 1 million women today directly on their mobile phones and tomorrow at their favorite pharmacy or retailer, all the while creating the industry's first and largest diverse skin imaging and health data set, ultimately decreasing the misdiagnosis rates of all women. And you can help us realize this vision by using this QR code to join our all-in campaign, to download the app and begin managing your skin health, and for women's organizations and brands, learn more about partnering with us. So with that, I look forward to having all of us join us in our journey in advancing the future of healthcare. Thank you.
Yes, yes, yes. All right, everyone. Let's help give a warm Atlanta welcome to the next CEO, Chris Morris from Rush Roto. Let's go.
Hi, I'm Chris Morris, founder and CEO of Rush Roto, and we're making product photography fast and affordable with AI. Now, I'm sure more than a few of us in this room have bought something online. Well, a couple years ago, my wife and I decided to open up an online shop. And if you sell anything online, what you need to get right is that product photo. And that is way easier said than done for a lot of businesses, especially ours. See, we're in the middle of Delaware. We quickly found out the closest product photographer over an hour away, they wanted $1,000 to do a shoot, and they wanted to keep the rights to all those photos. So naturally, we looked at the next option, which is mail-in services. Now, in our case, we would have to box and mail up and get shipped out dozens of items. And then imagine having to do that every single time you need to update for seasonality, adding a SKU, or just for a discount or a sale. And still, they would want $50 to $100 per photo that we got back from them. So we actually ended up with a room in our house that looked just like this, because now you're not just an entrepreneur, you're also a photographer. So you have to buy lenses, cameras, backdrops, lights, software, all types of equipment, and you have to spend dozens of hours and thousands of dollars trying to figure out how to use all this stuff. And we're not alone. There's actually 30 million people selling on places like Amazon, Etsy, eBay, and each of them deal with this problem on a near constant basis. It was at this point my wife looked at me and said, Chris, you've got 20 years in programming and you know videography, you can figure this out. And we husbands don't say this often enough, but she was right. And with that, I created Rush Roto, where you can use your phone to create professional product images in seconds. You can create campaigns in minutes, not months, and we kept the editing super simple. So think more like Instagram, less like Adobe. And this is what that looks like. You can take a picture of your product literally anywhere and get product on white photography. You can generate or add a background and then add a different motion element. So most of the folks we sell to actually use places like Instagram, Pinterest, and TikTok to stop their customers while they're scrolling. And things like this are what get that job done. So imagine this. You're selling a watch around Halloween. You take a picture, sit the watch right on your desk, and instantly transform it into something that's going to stop folks when they're scrolling on Instagram. It does better than you expect. So you take that same exact photo, and now you're using it for the holiday season too. And you get carried away, and there it goes for Easter as well. Now, this is just one of those use cases. There's actually many more that you can do with this tech. I'll show you one more later, actually. Now, our customers come to us because we actually are the best for e-commerce. We offer the best of all the worlds of the things they use prior to that. So we offer the ease of use of a Suna, like a mail-in service, the instant results you get from using an app, but yet we maintain the design freedom you get from tools like Canva and Adobe. Now, we charge $30 a month on average. It is actually a tiered pricing model. It's an $11 billion market globally, and we are targeting $100 million some. This is our fantastic team. Myself, Chris Morris, and Josh Nowoki is our lead UI UX designer. He has 5 years in UI UX and also programming, and is a two-time blockchain hackathon winner. I taught myself how to program, been programming for 20 years and taught myself how to do it at 15. You can see our excellent advisors down there for advertising, marketing, and also product. Now, this team is the team to get it done because we were able to move really quickly. So we went from developing our own proprietary AI model to get this done to getting the beta out, and then we actually launched the app at the top of this year. And we already are about to launch our web app in the next 2 weeks. And this is what that kind of quick velocity gets you. So in the first 45 days we've been out there, we've already hit $2,200 MRR, and we've actually done images for 10 national brands, some of which are actually going to appear on retail boxes that are going to be in Walmart very soon. And we hit that 300 mark, actually 275 plus in the past 30 days as well as users. We have the support of AWS with both cash and credits, and we also have the support of Delaware through the program Startup 302. Now, this is the example that I'm really proud of. There's actually a business down here in Atlanta that we were able to help out with a pilot. So this is something that's near impossible for most small businesses. Could you imagine having to book a model, figure out a photo shoot, who's gonna style them, and then even having to find a model that's willing to put on a wig for you to get that actual shoot done? So in this case, we were able to work on something that they're able to just take a picture of one of their mannequins and instantly generate the images that they need for their business, unlocking all types of revenue for them. So we're actually raising our 750K pre-seed round. And we've already got the smart money, and you can see there from Nextcubed and Techstars, obviously. And we're going to hit those milestones of getting on Shopify, launching our Android app, and also fine-tuning our enterprise suite as well. And with that, I just want to thank everyone for helping us make product photography fast and affordable with AI. And you can actually use that QR code to check out the app right now. Thank you very much.
All right. That was a picture-perfect pitch, Chris. Thank you. Hey, everyone, help get this crowd charged up for our next CEO, Desmond Wiggan, of BatteryXchange.
Greetings, everyone. I'm Desmond Wiggan. I'm the CEO and founder of BatteryXchange. We've created an immersive kiosk solution that integrates batteries and hardware. I know, it's not oftentimes the sexiest thing in the room, but over the next few moments, I'll share with you how we found a scalable model within healthcare. We focused on profitability and become bigger than just batteries in a untapped billion-dollar market opportunity. So I love to start with an origin story. Several years ago, I'm in mainland China, a part of my MBA program, and after a long day of traveling, I found myself in an inconvenience that we've all found ourselves in. I'm stranded with a dead cell phone, right? So I can't call an Uber. Naturally, I have high anxiety, right? And I can't tell my wife I'm headed home. And so in that moment, I'm like, why isn't there a more convenient way for us to charge our cell phone while we're on the go? I think we've all seen the solutions that are out there, the locker boxes that you leave a cell phone, or the charging stations with a whole bunch of cables that never work. We jokingly say that we're in the dial-up era of charging. You remember when only one person could be on the internet at a time? You know, our lifeline is our devices. And over the next few years, we'll have to charge some 15 billion devices. And we felt like we could be the Canva of the charging space. Not sure if you're familiar with Canva. They came in and really innovated and invigorated innovation into the PowerPoint industry. And so we decided to do something about it with BatteryXchange platform. So what we do is similar to the scooters or the bikes within the sharing economy. We strategically place our kiosk machines in different locations. Individuals can download our mobile application. They're able to find our kiosk machine, scan their QR code, get access to an external portable battery that's compatible with every single device on the market. Then they have autonomy over a 24-hour period to return that battery to any one of our kiosk machines. And throughout that time period, we're able to interact and engage with them through our mobile application. This is a recent launch that we had in Hartford, Connecticut. We launched 10 kiosk machines in a beautiful facility. And I want you to remember that 10, because it'll add relevance to a later slide. We're in their emergency room, surgical waiting room, all throughout the location. So I said we started with healthcare, and there were a few reasons why. One, they wanted to really engage with individuals in a more impactful way in that waiting room environment, right? And one of the things that was ultra important is they wanted to find a way to digitally engage within patient surveys, because these patient surveys allow them to get access to the $955 billion in reimbursements, keeping money in their pocket. So we're off to a great start. We have corporate partners such as Advocate Health, the sixth largest system in the entire nation. We're on track to be in 47 other locations. I talked about Hartford Health. And then because of our healthy margins, we're able to strategically align with organizations that put our product in front of hundreds and thousands of health systems. There we go. So super excited about the momentum that we're on. We just had a six-figure quarter. We 4X growth over the last few quarters as well. And we built our pipeline well above $1 million in ARR revenue. This is another thing that we're excited about. Hardware company, what does profitability look like? In our first quarter, on an average annual basis, we break even. In the first year, we see about 76% margins. And on a total contract value on a single kiosk machine, that's 24K profit on a single kiosk machine. So you remember that 10? That's 240K in profit from a single customer. So the kiosk, the batteries, the platform as a current state is our Trojan horse to open up doors to additional revenue streams. We have been looking at third-party advertisement as another way to bring in some revenue. Our customers are constantly asking for new functionalities, access to data, so that's that B2B SaaS platform. And we believe we can make any type of product smarter and more engaging. And so we have a retail vending play that we're looking to bring out as well. This is what growth looks like for us over the next few years. So we're going to race towards that $2 million in ARR within the current pipeline. And then we'll do like a land and expand to various health systems across the nation. And that's about a $300 million ARR value there, right? The good thing about this is there's a hospital in every local town, city, region, across the United States and across the globe. Then we're already doing some test and learns with some adjacent markets in city government, universities, professional sporting teams, and major event venues. And that's when we start to tap into the $1 billion of revenue. So what you see before, product-wise, it's not it. We're starting to integrate things like facial detection and artificial intelligence to really create better user experiences and extrapolation of data. So again, I ran track. So we're running past the competition. Offering this product for free to end users is a way for us to better engage with them and build loyalty throughout that standpoint. Our competitors are charging the end users. We're focused on a B2B value proposition, so that's why they're coming to us to enhance the functionality that we currently have, and we're tagging on to some of the things that they want to do around initiatives. One of the real cool things that we're able to do within our software is we're able to bring in additional softwares to create better user experiences and customer experiences, and then also be a tag on to customers that already have mobile applications. I'm really excited about my dream team. This is some of the individuals that are walking with me to build out BatteryXchange. My right-hand man, Ethan, he's built products for some of the largest retailers in the world. Jennifer brings over 20 plus years experience in supply chain and operations. And we're advised by a core team of individuals that have varying experience that allow us to really build this organization. Brian has exited his company several years back, helping us with business development. We have Wayne, a Google executive, that's helping us with go-to-market strategies. We have Spencer, retired now, used to manage a couple $1 billion in portfolio companies, helping us with financial modeling and as we scale into the future. And then lastly, Caleb Dixon currently sells innovation into healthcare systems, so he's helping us navigate through those quarters. So this is where we're at. We're raising $800K to sprint towards that $2 million in ARR. That's 200 kiosk machines, 5 new partners, 4 new markets. And I'm gonna leave you with this. Jamie Siminoff, the founder of Ring, said, if you can solve a simple global problem, you can create a $1 billion opportunity. And that's what we've created with BatteryXchange. And I look forward to chatting with you guys after.
All right, man. How are we all doing, everyone? Good? All right. Hey, we have a little technical difficulty. It's actually not a technical difficulty. Averett, our next CEO, is not here yet. He is literally driving from Alabama, screaming on some highway because he was bumped from his flight. So I thought it'd be a good time while we reshuffle some things just to talk about and shout some people out. And I thought about Averett.
screaming somewhere. And I really want to just give a little bit of context, I think, what makes us different. And his story reminds me of something I think about what we do at Next Cubed. It's about authentic hustle. As Averett is literally, he got bumped from Spirit, thank you, Spirit Airlines. And he nothing's going to stop him from getting here. Cameron, same story, I can tell you, for our kickoff in New York. He took an overnight bus from Baltimore to show up into New York City. And that's just, as you probably are seeing, the metal and the drive that these founders, in addition to the talent that they bring. And I think that's such a testament to the HBCU community that I feel so privileged to be a guest in. And so I thought that was a really logistically unfortunate, however, a very important reminder of why we're all here. On the same vein of authentic hustle, I wanted to also shout out the advisors. There's several advisors here. Eileen, Jack, who else am I missing? What's up? Our advisors are handpicked to work with our founders based on their expertise, and we match them specifically for their domain knowledge and technical ability. And they are so dedicated. They showed up here today in Atlanta on their own dime, and I'm humbled and so thankful for your talents and drive. I also thought it'd be great to shout out on Authentic Hustle, the team at Next Cubed. Kip, Caroline, Miranda, who else is here? And most importantly, Maggie is here. Zari is here, who we just brought on as an HBCU alumna. We're excited. And also my right hand, Kieran Quackenbush, who basically has just, I just stay out of her way, and she tells me what to do, and I just try not to mess it up. So thank you, Kieran, for all your efforts on this today. The last thing I want to talk about authenticity as well, and this is through Kieran's efforts. Everything you see today, the vendors to the venue we picked, are HBCU alum run and sponsored. So Modex, HBCU alum, all the goodies out there, all the food has been our HBCU alums, and we are so excited to be a full stack supporter of, who am I forgetting? And the photographers as well. Also, HBCU FI alum as well, right? So we have photographers as well. So we are keeping in the family, and we're very excited to be able to drive that full stack authenticity. With that, so a couple things on the. So we're going to bring up the next founder. If we have a break, we may have an intermission. We're going to invite people to come back for Averett's pitch. But I just want to preview that so people don't go and do whatever they have to do. It should be very close. We are literally parking his car for him and driving around. It's like that. But without further ado, I want to make the way for Queen Big Stepper herself, CEO of Vela Shoes, Ariana Edwards. Let's go. Ah, woo. Get up.
My name is Ariana Edwards, and I'm the proud founder and CEO of Vela Shoes. Psychologists have long since proven that if you look good, you feel good, right? Yet, millions of women don't have the opportunity to do either. I was one of them. My feel-good moment is when I embody the lifestyle of a businesswoman. Okay, I would buy the two-piece dress suits, the accessories, everything that I could, but one thing that I can never find were shoes. I wear an 11 wide, and when I'm shopping for shoes to accommodate my business lifestyle, I always run into shoe racks with little to no options. I find myself going to multiple stores, shopping online for hours, even borrowing shoes. And it wasn't until my senior year of college where I got fed up. Imagine having the dream interview of your college career. You know, you're preparing everything from your hair to your outfit to your interview responses, but the only thing that you could find were these faded, ran down black flats without soles hanging off, and they didn't even smell too good because you wore them everywhere. Well, that was me. In a world where first impressions matter, I couldn't help but think that I was very insecure externally. And I also pretty much sorry. And also, in the midst of everything, I couldn't help but to imagine how many people judge me because of what I had on my feet. And I'm not alone. 25 million U.S. women go through the same problem of finding fashionable and professional shoes in their extended shoe size. For decades, we've been unsupported by society's beauty standards and unconsidered within the retail footwear market. The global women's dress shoe market is a $130 billion industry, and our served market taps into $40 billion of it. Our target market is only purchasing two pairs of shoes per year, while the average woman is purchasing six. Us women are missing out on the opportunity to show up as our best selves. So you may be wondering, why aren't there more larger sizes out there? Well, there's not enough data in the United States that tracks shoe sizes, which becomes a supply and demand problem. Despite the opportunity, retailers would much rather stay out of this space to avoid cost, slow speed to market, and not so quick returns. Plus, they can't find any brands for their platform. Brands would rather stay out of this space because they feel like it takes so much time and money to make the right product and also market it. Instead of cutting corners, they would much rather focus on their smaller sizes and make money off of their larger margins. So that's where Vela comes in, and where we give feminine power back to women of forgotten shoe sizes. After interviewing over 300 women, it was clear I needed to create Vela to give us availability. Vela is a modern dress shoe brand for women with extended shoe sizes of 9 through 14, and we create seasonal collections designed for the workplace and after hours. We're an online direct-to-consumer brand, and when customers purchase Vela shoes, we receive an average 65% gross margin. We also engage in online marketplaces and wholesale partnerships. So, big feet need bigger shoes, but more than that, they need the right fit. Unlike competitors, we focus on construction and community, meaning our shoes are re-engineered for the larger foot with spacious toe boxes to avoid irritation, thicker heel bases for support, wider soles for stability, and cushion for comfort. These are all things that give us balance, not blisters. Over 60% of women are already wearing shoes that are smaller than their size. So this is pretty much where we play within the market. And we're not talking about just style, we're talking about health. Plus, we're focused on dress shoes, which is the hardest category for our customers to find. 10 toes down, our customers say one thing. I know when I get Vela shoes that they are going to fit. And it shows because our community of big steppers love our shoes and they keep on coming back. But not just our community, but press with articles about how this black, woman-owned, first-generation HBCU founder is making strides within the footwear industry. In just 2 years, we reached six figures. Last year, we launched in Macy's in five Macy's doors, including their New York flagship location. This year, we're launching into DSW, and with more partnerships in our pipeline, it's clear that we have what it takes to step ahead. I've assembled an amazing team of advisors with background in the industry, with working at companies such as Kate Spade and Nine West. Me as a founder, I truly understand our customers because I've literally been in their shoes. My background is in sales and marketing from numerous Fortune 500 companies. And I've also been proud to be named on the 2023 Forbes 30 Under 30 Atlanta list. Thank you. So our goal here is to reach more big steppers, and we're going to continue doing that through our wholesale partnerships and then also with building a multi-channel marketing strategy. We also plan to expand our assortment so that we can reach different target markets, such as uniform employees. But we also have been doing some soul searching for investors and people who can help us in these areas who really truly believe about the impact that we can make within the industry. At Vela, our mission is to have our customers embody the boss woman that they are, not what society has to find for them. So for all the women out there with a size 9 shoe and above, know this. Your foot size is bold, beautiful, classy. There are amazing shoe options for you to choose from, and you can find them all on Vela. Thank you so much. Scan the QR code and let a big stepper know.
All right, so crushed it. Averitt is literally, I think, two or three minutes out, I think, parking the car, and I think Kieran is literally grabbing the keys from him, parking the car for him. So what I thought I would do is leave a little time for you. So I don't want no one go anywhere. I'll leave some time for questions. This is a nice crowd. So if not, I'll start asking questions of the founders as well. But I wanted to leave the mic open and have a discussion. You know, are there any questions from the audience for any of the founders you've seen so far about how or about any enterprise? And I'm happy to pass the mic, and then we'll maybe get some Q&A going in the space between.
I have a question.
Janelle, go ahead. Here, I'll give you the mic.
It's totally a loaded question because I worked with Ari at Vela. But what, if I could ask Ari, what would she have an ask of this crowd for Vela?
Thank you, Janelle, an amazing advisor. Yes, so for Vela, we definitely want to be able to enter into markets. Oh, go to the front, I'll do that too, excuse me. Yes, for Vela Shoes, we definitely want to be able to enter into different markets. Of course, we definitely want to serve the general market, which are women who wear a size 9 and up and who primarily work in corporate offices. But we do have a goal to actually go into uniform employees and also government contracts. So this means airlines, right? How about flight attendants for their uniforms? This also means government employees such as security guards, right? We really want to get into that private label where we can be able to serve companies across all sizes, but we're starting with the larger sizes because that's an empty gap. That and just letting the sister know because somebody is struggling with finding shoes right now. So, yes, thank you.
Anyone? Good, here you go. No, we got people at home, Rowan.
Oh, sure, yeah. Right on. So, what about the guys? So, I've got a big, wide foot, and I'm not a big guy, but I've got wide feet. So, why just ladies? Why not the gentlemen, too?
I get asked that all the time. Why not guys? Well, I can say I do have a lot more fun with designing for women because we love the options in the footwear. And especially if you're talking about dress shoes, I found that the guys, they love the black, browns, and beiges. Like, so guys are definitely something that we do want to tap into. But I think in terms of the market and what we have to wear to the workplace, women can get away with some flats, some sneakers, a lot of things. So we're going to start with them first, but maybe there's definitely a future for men. Thank you for the question.
Terrence, question for maybe other the founders too.
Here you go. Where's Desmond at? Where's Desmond? Hey, Desmond. I like your sneakers. We got the same type of sneaker. Hardware. Interesting. What costs are associated with the product, and also how do you see kind of the future of that space in the next 5 years? It's moving really fast with batteries and things of that nature. So what are the costs and how do you see the future of that within the next couple of years?
Perfect. So I talked a little bit about my experience internationally. So I was able to build a really unique relationship with my manufacturer. And so our cost, so we're going to market with about $8,900. That's the cost to the customer. It costs us about $2,500 all in for the batteries, the kiosk, the technology into that. And so that's where we get that 76% margin for the year. What we're looking at over the next few years is trying to create the next level of charging. We're working on a potential patent right now where you'll literally be able to walk into an environment and be able to truly wirelessly charge with nodes that are in the buildings versus having to connect to devices. But our kiosk machines and some of the things that we're doing there and beacons and all of those opportunities would kind of create that. So that's kind of one of the spaces there. Then I kind of mentioned the retail vending side. So that's another area that we believe we'll be able to kind of add value to it. Taking what we're doing in the mobile application world, bringing experiences there, specifically in healthcare within retail pharmacy. So some communities don't necessarily have access to CVSs, in driving distance. And so being able to put that in those communities. And then the advertisement is that other component that kind of brings all three of the worlds together.
Yeah. Oh. You got one more chance? One more, and Avery's here, so we got to get going.
No, do your thing, man.
So, Blair, Howard University, HU, you know. I didn't go there, but your team, obviously there are a lot of ramifications for fertility care and things of that nature. Can you kind of express the experience of the team surrounding this outside? I think you may have spoken a little bit about yourself, but kind of want to kind of dig deep more into that and their experience with this.
Yeah, definitely. So my co-founder, especially Dr. Juliana Zaccardelli, who I'll bring up here, worked in fertility clinics, and me being a patient who's gone through that journey, she's seen it from the other side, right, as a provider. And we also have Dr. Omir Rahim, who's our chief medical officer, and he's the leading male reproductive urologist in the nation. And there are only but so few of them. I'll let you also add to that.
Yeah, so so Dr. Rahim is obviously our CMO, is on staff with us, and then we have an advisory board that also includes a few reproductive physicians as well. So Dr. Klein is the chief clinical officer at a fertility clinic in New York City called Extend Fertility. We also have another reproductive urologist who's at the University of Miami. So you know, all of our protocols and the way we built the workup was in discussion with those clinical advisors and our clinical board. We follow everything that's recommended by the American Society of Reproductive Medicine, which is the governing body of reproductive medicine. They have certain standards and protocols and things that are supposed to happen. And then along with our advisors, we're always kind of like on the cusp of what is coming out with reproductive medicine, what the ASRM is recommending. This hasn't been publicized yet, but they're about to release a practice committee opinion on telehealth infertility. And so we're always kind of abreast of those trends in combination with our advisors.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that the way that we built out our platform and how we have providers, we are licensed and credentialed in all 50 states, right? Right now our pilot is available in, 11 states? And those providers, we get them through our telehealth partner, Open Loop, and they become Zuri providers through that way. So it extends broader than that. And those providers also give us feedback, talk with us, and help us, you know, iterate on our product so that we can make it better for the patients. So, yeah.
All right. Thank you, guys. Thank you for the questions, everyone. I think it's a good preview, hopefully, for a spirited cocktail happy hour afterwards, and also for people at home, those comments hopefully can come in on the stream and we'll get to them asynchronously. But without further ado, the CEO and founder of Cashpool, Averett Barksdale.
Thank you. Can you guys hear me okay?
I think you can.
All right. How's everybody doing tonight?
Good.
I'm doing good. It's been a long little time, but here I'm good. Never do spirit. I'm gonna let y'all know. Don't do spirit. But yeah, let's hop into it. My name is Averett Barksdale. I am the CEO of Cashpool, and I'm here to talk to you today about how we are going to change the retail trading market. This is my brother and I. This is in 2017. We just started new careers where we were actually making money, like not little money, but better money. And we really wanted to double down on how much we were making with that money. So we started to do some research and we came across stock market trading. We thought it was gonna be very easy. We thought we were gonna make a ton of money, and we did not. We actually lost way more money than we actually put in. And it was actually a very tragic time for us. So we started doing research, and then we started to understand this problem was bigger than us. That 90% of all retail day traders lose money every year. This was mind-blowing. This was also scary, and we decided to stay away from it. We're like, okay, 90%, we're not ever going to be the 10%. So we stayed away. But fast forward a little bit, 2020 hits. We all remember that time. Then most of us should remember what happened in the financial market. In the financial market, the main thing that went on in 2020 was us focusing on a guy named Roaring Kitty and a social media group called Wall Street Bets. So we hopped back into stock market, right? We put money down, a lot of money. And the thing about it is, we got caught up in that whole situation where Robinhood wouldn't let us take the money out. But it was the first time in my life ever I had seen so much money shoot up in such a short period of time. So now we looked at it, and at that time, most people thought that the financial market really was like blowing up. But what we saw was a good opportunity because we felt that there were probably 100,000 plus more Roaring Kitties out there. And Roaring Kitty let us know why people were not successful in the stock market. Why? Because they lacked strategy. It took a ton of time to do research. It took a ton of time to read charts. And to be frank, most of us in here really don't have that time. We're working our jobs, we have our families, and everything else is going on in our lives. Here's the visual of Roaring Kitty. Here's also the visual of Wall Street Bets. These two together, we only placed one bet. Only one. And that changed the whole world that we lived in together. This was interesting because we started to do more research and then we realized 79% of Gen Z and millennials say that they get their financial information from social media. So now this let us know that there were definitely more Roaring Kitties out there. And as we break into it, here's the process that those Roaring Kitties go through, right? There's normally at least 5 different products that they have to go through in the sales funnel, which now makes them look more like digital marketers than actual traders, right? And it takes so much time for them to actually get to that retail trader and get that information across. So that's why we created Cashpool, a trading marketplace for both discovering and managing automated strategies. Our marketplace is focused on being able to get that information from the financial influencer to the retail trader in real time. And by real time, we also mean execute it. So now they're copying trades in real time. Our whole marketplace is focused on being able to unlock knowledge and share it amongst all of us. So a financial influencer can come to our platform, easily create a profile by connecting their brokerage account. We take all of their trading history, we put it onto that profile, and we make it very easily readable and to be seen. After that, they can then create what's called a pool. Those are trading strategies on our platform. Once they create that pool, they actually get a link that they can share out to their social media profiles, and they can say, hey, community, hey, followers, join my pool. Very simple process. Now, for the follower can join through that link, or they could just download the app from the actual app store. But once they get on the platform, they'll be able to see a limitless amount of actual financial influencers and their strategies. Once they see one that they like, they can actually connect their brokerage account and then join as many pools as they want. But the main thing that makes us special is that we're broker agnostic. So all the people who had their Robinhood accounts, Webull accounts, all these different trading brokerages, we allow them to come to our platform with all of them. This makes us special because our competitors are more focused on assets under management, or they're more focused on the actual trades being executed on their platform. But for us, we just care about knowledge being shared amongst people. That's our main focus. Why is that our main focus? That allows us to reach the larger market, and the larger retail market is worth $7.7 trillion. We plan to go after the first 2 million brokerage accounts that are already focused on automated trading. We plan to monetize them by saying each pool is $5 per month. We split this with the influencer, a 70-30 split. We plan to go after influencers initially, and don't worry about the user base or followers, just creating and stopping this process and having an easier tool that streamlines everything for them. Since joining NextCube, we've gone through a lot. We've been really heads down on product. we've been able to release our beta. After that, we've been able to sign on our first 50 influencers. Then we've been able to actually raise our pre-seed of $800,000, which was an exciting time for us that we closed in on. Thanks to Mike Ma, he really helped like that whole deal. So NextCube has been amazing for us. And this is the team behind it. Myself and my brother, we have over 10 years of experience of building trading platforms for Fidelity, Charles Schwab, and JP Morgan. So if you are ready to change the retail market with us, scan the QR code below and please get in contact. Thank you guys.
Stay up there, Avery. We're gonna bring everyone on. Hey, no, don't go anywhere. I want to bring all the founders up here for a second. And just to add more depth to this conversation we have about authentic hustle and grind, I want to invite my boss, Marlon Evans, who, while Avery was screaming down the highway, he was also coming in from the UK on planes, trains, and emails. So, Marlon, I'm going to invite Marlon up on stage, and you can take us home, man. What do you say? Give him some love. Give him some love, please.
This is not what I was planning on wearing for this this show. Started the day at 4 o'clock this morning in Oxford, through Frankfurt, and I was on time, and it was right circling above Atlanta, and they said, no, we got to divert you to Birmingham, which I guess that's where everyone's world's also, and then took an Uber here, so apologies. But I was able to watch it on live stream. We have over 100 people watching it on live stream, which is awesome. The founders did an amazing job. We are so excited about the opportunity for us to showcase these amazing founders. Like I said, this work has now taken us to places like Oxford, and there's a lot of interest, there's a lot of support. So we're super excited about what's in front for these founders. If there's a way that you can help them, just think of one thing that you can do for one of the founders that can go a long way. We talk a lot about how sometimes small doors can lead to big rooms. So just an introduction that you can make on their behalf to somebody in your network could go a super long way. So thank you so much. I see Jade, who is here, who is one of the original founders of our HBCU Founders Initiative. Make sure Jade gets a shout out. But yeah, thank you so much for coming out. We're going to do a little photo here. There's going to be food and stuff in the back. So I hope you get a chance to hang out and talk to the founders one-on-one. Thank you.
Real quick, thank you, Marlon. On behalf of Cohort 2, a lot of work that we do and see as founders goes thankless, but we wanted to thank Kieran, especially for being a great help behind the scenes. So come on, get these flowers, get your flowers. So this is from Cohort 2, and we just want to say thank you, and thank you all for coming out.
All right, we're going to need some photos, but you guys should get drinks. It is Thursday night. We're in ATL. We got great founders. We got drinks. We got food. I can't think of a better place to be, so go do that thing. We're going to take some pictures. You should grab some pictures, too, when you can after we're done, and then I'll see you out there, and we'll have a good old time outside. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you for being on the live stream. Appreciate everyone for being part of this community. Thank you so much.
I'm so proud of you. I'm so proud.